2015, world leaders committed to providing quality health services to everyone by 2030. We have less than 10 years to reach the goal of universal health coverage, and yet over half the world still lacks access to essential primary health care. As a consequence, 930 million people are at risk of falling into poverty due to out-of-pocket spending on their health needs. Digital technologies hold the potential of accelerating progress to health for all. Effectively deployed, digital technologies can strengthen health systems, support individuals to better manage their own health, and enhance the availability, accessibility, affordability, and quality of health services. Digital Health Week is a global moment to champion the role of digital health in universal health coverage. During Digital Health Week, organizations around the world are coming together to host events, make public commitments, and shine a light on the successes and challenges of digital health and UHC in their contexts. During Digital Health Week, civil society, private companies, government health ministries, and interested individuals are discussing the challenges and opportunities for digital health in their countries and regions. How far has digital health come? What barriers must still be overcome?
Our work on improving HIV rights and sexual and reproductive health and rights in Kenya, it is no longer possible to ignore the potential that digital health holds in improving access to health services and realizing the right to health.
YAPMI, or the Universal Public Health Association, commits to working for the goal of universal health coverage to our 35,000 members. The time to champion digital technologies in achieving health for all is now, and we'll be hosting the second annual Public Health Center Conference in Zagreb and bring together leaders from across Indonesia and promote digital health.
As we build a digitally enabled future, it's imperative that the voices of young people are not left out of the design, planning, and implementation of these interventions. Digital Health Week is an exciting opportunity for young people to showcase their digital health solutions, as we will be doing through the Humans of Digital Health campaign by Younger Age.
The first Global Digital Health Week is being coordinated by Transform Health. We are a coalition of organizations committed to championing the role of digital technology and data to achieve universal health coverage by 2030.
We want to see the transformation of health systems to ensure that everyone has access to equitable, affordable, and quality healthcare by harnessing the potential of digital technologies whilst ensuring no one is left behind. This requires stronger political will, a clear health data governance framework grounded in human rights and equity, and increased and coordinated investments towards digital health.
So join us during Digital Health Week to champion health for all in the digital age. Hold discussions, make commitments, and amplify the role of digital health on your organization's website and on social media.
evening to everyone. I think I am very happy that we are now celebrating digital health all over the world. And this is our region in Asia. And today, I and Standard and Interoperability Health Thailand are really happy to share our experience and practice, and also discuss with our communities all over Asia about our new projects that try to integrate healthcare insurance claim with fast healthcare interoperability resources standard. Today, we will have a series of panels, but we will have a break during the third or fourth session. It depends on how well we can proceed. But during the talk, I think you can ask the question and also comment into the chat in the chat room. Our secretariat can correct these comment questions, and then we will open the floor for discussions later. So I am happy to introduce our speaker, which is the SILS Standard and Interoperability Lab Thailand members and also our partner. I will starting first. And then Dr. Papat and pharmacist Nadanai from Sirirat Mahidol Medical School, Mahidol University, will be talking about the fire in Sirirat hospitals with the CSOP projects. And then our partner from HealthTech, the startup, one of the success startup in Thailand, Dr. Dechawut Pomda, you talking about the combination of fire and blockchain technology in the Sirirat CSOP projects. Then one of our member, the expert on the fire expert in Thailand, Dr. Lat Panyowat, will talking about the new initiative of the National Health Reform Commission's health data integration, and talking in the part of developing standard in this initiative. The final presentation will be our partner from governmental big data institutes under the Ministry of Digital Health, Economy and Societies, Dr. Thanakrit Chintawon. Dr. Thanakrit will explain more on the part that the GDBI doing in this initiative, and also will talking about the program that the GDBI are trying are linking the information system between health provider all over the countries. And then we will have a session for discussion and question and answers. So let's start. I think many of you are AHIN member are familiar with AHIN, and you see the video introducing AHIN already. During the past 10 years, we learn from each other a lot, and what we come up with the kind of the knowledge while trying to develop the national health information system, digital health in the countries. And we find a lot of challenge. And we summarize our lesson and come up with the the framework that every that we found that every country need to work on this very important foundation of digital health or e-health in order to if the country want to develop the effective national health care information system. And we found we named this framework as GAPS. So countries are facing the challenge of developing digital health to serve the universal healthcare coverage or primary healthcare on or healthcare services because of we did not work in hard enough on these four components. So we name it that we should mind the gap. And the gap that we should mind is G, the governance, A, the architecture, the enterprise architecture of the health information system. And three, the people and the program management expertise and skill. And the third one is the working on the standard and interoperabilities. We as communities are working toward laying down these foundations. So we hope that one day we can fill the gaps. So we will have every country in our region will have the effective national health information system. So today we are going to talk about the chair, the component, the standard and interoperability component of that frameworks. In AHIN community, we support standard and interoperability lab in every country. So we forming the what we call the community of interoperability lab or COIN. And we are working closely with our architects, which is all AHIN member, all the health professional that are certified by certified as the enterprise architects, which is AHIN working and support this kind of the knowledge building capacities. So the regional enterprise architecture council for health, which is chaired by Dr. Alvin Marcello, our executive director, is also here, and he can explain more for the question if any about the reach. And the COIN, the community of the interoperability lab, is the each country from gathering the passionate people who want to help build the interoperable health information system. Would like to have the health information exchange across the healthcare spectrum. Right now, there is at least four active standard in the interoperability lab in countries. Thailand also, we also gathering the interest people to form the interoperability lab Thailand or SIL Thailand. And with our friend from the other country also gathering people from different organization and form the group that will work on the standard and interoperability, like standard and interoperability Philippines, Vietnam, Indonesia. And we also have our support from the Asia Development Bank, who hosts the standard and interoperability lab Asia. So SIL Thailand, or Standard Interoperability Lab Thailand, is forming from the interest of the people who work in the area of the digital health, e-health, health information system, คอมพิวเตอร์เอนจิเนียร์ไอทีเฮลท์โปรเฟชชั่นอล who think that we our country should have the interoperable health information system that the information can be seamlessly exchanged across the all spectrum of healthcare system and health and public health. And we come from different
health information technologies are rapidly growing around the world. There are many hospital information systems and personal health information systems developed in both government and private sectors, which cannot be interoperable effectively due to the complexity of healthcare system and lack of information standards. However, the health information standards are not a solution. Stakeholders through the interoperability training and workshops by partnering with CilHR. Two, we set up the interoperability tools, especially HL75, to enable all stakeholders to learn and implement the applications that support the international standards. Testing. We provide a conformance testing platform that allows software vendors and healthcare facilities to test their applications against the international standards and also certify their applications to ensure that their applications can be interoperable with international standards. For more information, please visit our website and feel free to contact us. We are looking forward to collaborating with you.
And this is the AHIN member, and we will have a standard and interoperability lab communities right now in the right group, like 60-70 people are interested in the working on standard and interoperability. Our leader is Dr. Prapat Suryapol. Dr. Prapat is the associate professor at the Faculty of Medicine, Sri Lanka Hospital, Mahidol University. And Dr. Prapat is our technical lead on in SIL Thailand. I also working with the team as the clinical lead. And Dr. Piya Han Wolawongchai is associate professor at the Faculty of Medicine, Chulalongkorn University, and he is one of our policy lead that will connect us to the policy maker and in health system. And also we have the member come from Ministry of Public Health and also come from the another from the university, from the public health, and from the other organization. And today, four of us are going to talking about the works that we have experienced in the past 2 years, in 2019 to up to now. And we are going to have the projects related to the HL75. I will starting with the health universal healthcare coverage in Thailand. Thailand has achieved universal healthcare coverage since 2002, and we have three major health insurance scheme. The big insurance we call the universal healthcare scheme, which is cover 48 million people. And the oldest is the civil servant medical beneficiary scheme. And from this slide, you can see that they have a different funding resources and also have a little bit different payment mechanism to the beneficiary. But every Thai citizen will be in one of these healthcare scheme. And since 2002, every scheme also providing reimburse the healthcare services to the hospitals and clinic. And different scheme are setting the data set standard and also the specification for claiming data. The first and oldest one is the civil servant beneficiary scheme, or we call CSMBS, and they pay this insurer pay the hospital with the model of fee for service. So they have design or specify standard data set for the hospital to send for the reimbursement. And this data set has been exchanged between hospital and the payers or insurer for almost 10 years. So hospital are familiar with this local standardized data set that they will exchange between the provider and the insurers. So if we use the open HIE architecture as the model, that we have the share asset, which is the standard standard data set, standard code value set, and also other part like the registry of the provider and the patient, then we can share the benefit by using the care services. If we use this kind of the architecture and model, and we can define, we can mapping that in Thailand, we have done or we have developed several standard, mostly for claim system. We haven't got into the area of the describe fully clinical data, but that is our aim, to have the more standardized data, not just for the claiming or administration purposes. So this is the mapping that the standard that we have. You can see that in the red box, that we in Thailand, we already have the national citizen ID to identify patient. We have hospital ID to identify hospitals. We implement ICD-10. We implement the financing tool like the DRG, diagnostic related group payment tools. We, in the last 8 years, we developed the way to identify drug called the TMT, Thai medicine terminology. And in the last 2 years, we developed Thai medical laboratory terminology that identify the laboratory order from the providers. And we also define or have the standard for reporting and also to send the data to for the reimbursement. We call them 12-5 standard. And for the civil servant beneficiary scheme, we have standard for outpatient and also inpatient. For the outpatient, we call the civil servant outpatient claim data. And for the inpatient, we call the ICIPN. So if you can see that to be able to interoperable the system, we need at least 5 layers of the interoperability. Start from technical interoperability up to the business and process interoperability, and each layer need a standard. Currently we have our own our standard is not internationally compliant. So when right now HL7 fire is one of the standard that every health information system or healthcare information system are adopting this standard, including the major health techs. So you can see that HL7 fire specify several layers of the standard, both semantic, syntactic, and also the structure of the data set. So in the CSOP data set, which is the standard data set for outpatient claim service, which is mandated by Civil Servant Beneficiary Scheme or CSMBS. In that data set, already have several data elements that standardize. We have patient ID, we have provider ID, drug item encode in the TMT, laboratory order encode in the TMLT. We also have the chart data. So, and all of these has the data element is there that they already exchange. So we think that is it possible or how is feasible that we will developing or evolving our local standard into the international standard like FIRES. So this is the originate of the our interest, and we work in SEAL, and we have several projects in the past 2 years that working on the HL7 fire. So I will finish my presentation here and would like to give it to the floor to Dr. Prapat Suryapol to talking later about the project that related to fire. Over to you, Dr. Prapat.
Yep. Thank you, Dr. Bunchai. Thank you very much, and it is my honor to have an opportunity to talk for the Data Health Week. So I will follow up with what Dr. Bunchai has mentioned. Just introduce myself a little bit. So I am Prapat Suryapol. Right now I'm the director of Silat Informatics and Innovation Center, or we as known as SI Data Plus at Silat Hospital, Maidon University, and I also one of the member of SIL Thailand or Standard and Interoperability Lab Thailand. As Dr. Bunchai mentioned, in Thailand, we have a lot of required data set, mostly from the reimbursement scheme that all the hospital, they have to send the data set to the payer to get all the reimbursement. And the problem with the required data set is all this constraint. I mean, normally we can think of it into two things, the constraints. One is the content, because the content for each scheme, they have very specific. I mean, you have to put in the content exactly what they require, no more and no less. If you don't put it that way, you don't get the reimbursement. And also the format. If you put in the correct content but different format or the wrong format, it's also invalid, and then you cannot get the reimbursement. So this is two constraints that has been become the pressure for the hospital. So our hospital have to generate the required data set and have to use it to send out. And who gonna do that? It can be the hospital information system, the HIS company that the hospital use. They can create the required data set, or if the hospital is big enough and have their own IT team, they can have the IT team to generate it. Or if they don't have IT, the hospital have to spend money and ask the outsources to do it. And I mean, any choices here, it requires time and money, and all hospital have to do it. So it's really wasteful for us. So about 2 years ago, our SIT Thailand, we got support to do the pilot project. And then we want to create a dashboard for NCD, non-communicable disease patient, using standard FHIR. And this is one of the web page that we designed. This is the overview of the latest encounter of a patient. So on the screen, we have it's common, like a name of the patient, age, birthday, marriage status, adverse drug reaction, weight, and then we have name of the doctor that last met the patient, the time and date of encounter, blood pressure, and our observation or laboratory, and also the medication. Okay, so this like a general web page to show the overview of the patient. And then in our design, we said that, okay, now we make it different. Before, the programmer, they have to work on their web application, and they also have to talk to the hospital, asking that I want this data and this data, what can we get it from the hospital information system that the hospital used? What is the database structure and whatsoever? But in this project, we just separate, decouple it. We said that, nope, you don't have to go and talk to the hospital. You just go to the FHIR website and then study there and get whatever you want from the resources. Okay, so this is where the programmer will go there and try to see whether whatever resources or whatever data they want, they just try to get it from the HR7 FHIR website, or the document is there. And they hardly come back to us and kind of consult and talk, because there are some technical term or medical term that they don't really understand. But most of the information, they can get it from the FHIR website. But the problem for our team is that for FHIR interface, right now, the programmer, they know that they can assume that all the data is available here. But who gonna implement this part? So it will come to us. And the first decision that we have to make is that, should we use the FHIR server or should we use the FHIR facade? Facade is like a window that you don't really store the data here, but it's like a window that when the programmer asks to get some data, your interface, you have to go to the HIS system of the hospital and get the data and bring back to the programmer. And at the beginning, we thought that facade is a good way because it reduces the complexity. We don't have to keep another set of data. But it turned out that we were wrong. This is the lesson that we learned, that for quick implementation, using FHIR server is faster to implement. I would say that what we learned is that to implement the facade is better to have this job for the HIS company who know most about their product. If as a SIL and we want to demonstrate and educate people how to use FHIR interface, I think using FHIR server is much better choice. And we think we can keep with the complexity that keep another set of data. Because we learned that to use FHIR server, it is less invasive and we have minimal hospital information disturbance. We can have a system that run at night and then take the data and post it into the FHIR server. And FHIR server have the ready-made FHIR interface that can support the programmer. Or in this case, we just create the database trigger that once the data get inside the HIS system of the hospital, and then that trigger also kind of replicate or send the data to the FHIR server as well. And this worked quite okay for our pilot study. So what we learned from this part is that we learned it firsthand that FHIR is really good for implementation, because the programmer, they has long finished their work on the web application before we finish our work in putting the data into the FHIR interface. So it means that once we have FHIR interface, implementation downstream is really, really good. And another good thing about the FHIR interface is that if that web application, they connect to another hospital, maybe in the same chain or whatever, they can just pull the data from this two interface and integrate the data. It means that it doesn't matter whether the patient visit hospital A or visit hospital B, all their history can be integrated and displayed based on their timeline on the website. Or if hospital A and B are different, the same web application can be shared and can be reused quite easily because they have the same FHIR interface. Then come to our project that other speaker going to talk a bit more detail about this, is that, I mean, when we work with one hospital information system like HISA, and to get the data from that HIS and put it into FHIR server, I mean, it need a lot of knowledge and need a lot of time. And then we have some kind of dilemma that why we want to invest our resources on one HIS, why not another one? So what is the choice that we can pick up which HIS we want to work with? So this is quite a dilemma that, I mean, we want to move forward, but we can't really make decision that which HIS we should go for. I mean, actually we hope that all the HIS will see the benefit of FHIR and then they create, I mean, they change their own software to support the FHIR interface. Because we know that if our hospital, they have FHIR interface, it will really support the hospital information system, right? I mean, Dr. Tanaki may talk later that, I mean, once you have this interface, you don't have to ask our hospital to generate things for you. You just create one software and ask permission, and then that software can just pull the data from our hospital after they get the permission. So this is really, I mean, lean and cost efficient. And also personal health record that we are working on the CSOP project that other speaker will talk about. We try to have some baby step for personal health information system as well, that the patient can have the medication in their mobile phone, right? And this will open the floor for health tech ecosystem, right? Because right now all health tech startup company, when they want to work on something, they have to really go deep into the hospital information system and try to extract the data out there. And then different hospital will have another system. And then because they are startup, they don't have that much resources to work with, right? But if they can work with the same interface, I mean, this is really build up the ecosystem for the health tech startup to grow. So in the end, we come up with this, and you remember this one at the beginning of my slide, right? And one of the required data set that really common in Thailand is the CSOP data set, the standard data set for outpatient that is mandatory for the civil servant medical beneficiary scheme, right? So any hospital information system in Thailand, if they want to claim for this, they must be able to generate this FHIR. It is, we call it data set, but actually it is just FHIR that created every day and sent out to the payer. So we ask the hospital that, hey, you have already have this file. So we will create a tool, I mean, free of charge. I mean, this project, we're going to release a tool free of charge. One is the file a server with authentication on top. I mean, we put some security on top and we release it as the Docker container. And we also create a CSOP file parser that will read the CSOP file format and post all the data into the Fire server. And then we will also create mobile application, it's progressive web application that allow patient to access their medication history via mobile phone. So with this plan, we minimize work requirement for the hospital because they nearly doesn't have to do anything except that the executive just say yes for this project that we would like to try, because they already have this file, right? And then we provide all the tools free of charge. And our plan is that we would like to introduce the file interface for all hospital that would like to join this project, because we will release the file server as a Docker container that they can run it, I mean, quite easily. And in this case, we also have the real use case for both patient and doctor, because the patient can access their medication history via mobile phone. They don't have to carry a bag of tablets and machine to see the doctor and show the doctor that, hey, I have all this prescribed for me. And doctor can also access the patient medication history from other hospital as well. So this is the plan, like a baby step, that the first step that we try to introduce the fire, educate all the people involved, and try to do a real use case for that. But this is not all smooth path. So I would like to give the floor to pharmacist Nathanai. He can elaborate more about how much work have to do when we want to map the CSOP data set into FHIR. Okay, Dr. Nathanai, please.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Nathanai Thaiphat. I am a member of the SIL Thailand. And today I would like to share my experience on the mapping CSOP claim dataset to the FHIR resources. For the CSOP, is Dr. Bapat mentioned that CSOP is a standard data model that we use for the medical reimbursement in the OPD service for the civil servant medical benefits scheme, and also we also use this data set in the social security scheme. And the CSOP consists of the three sets of the information, including the Bhutan, Buddhist, and OP service. For the Bhutan, Bhutan is information about the billing transaction that a hospital used for claim for the reimbursement from the payer, and also include the billing claim item such as the medication dispense and the OPD service. And for the Buddhist data set, include the information about the dispensing medication, and also the detail of the dispensing item and the dosage instruction about the medication that dispensed to the patient. And for the OP service, is information of the service and procedure that hospital provide to the patients, and also the information of the diagnostic detail. And this ER diagram show the relationship between the data set from the Bhutan, Buddhist, and OP service. And you will see the invoice number, the record number 5 in the Bhutan. This invoice number is a reference key that we use for the reimbursement process. And the invoice number can be connect to the data set in the Buddhist and OP service. And for the individual building item, we can link with the dispensing ID and also the service ID that can connect to the billing item. And for the FHIR resource, in FHIR standard, the information exchange are based on the FHIR resources. Meta from the common data elements that widely used about 80% in the healthcare system. But in FHIR, they allow the implementer and developer to define their custom element or extension that are not available in the core dataset. For example, we can define the necessity to the patient resource as an extension. And for the mapping CSOP dataset to the FHIR resource, we can map built-in dataset to the FHIR resource such as the patient, claim, organization, and location resource. And for build this dataset, we can map to the encounter medication dispense and practitioner resource. And for the OP service, we can map to the encounter procedure condition, practitioner, and appointment resource. And as a FHIR claim that the FHIR resource cover about 80% of the information that used in the healthcare system. So for the mapping with the FHIR core data element in the built-in, we can map with the 84% for built-in and 89% for built-in and 96% for the OP service. But in our project, we will focus only on the medication information. So only the information that used in the built-in and built-in dataset will be transformed to the FHIR resource. And this diagram show the FHIR resource and the relationship that we extract from the built-in and built-in dataset, including the claim, location, medication dispense, encounter, patient, practitioner, and the organization resource. And for FHIR profile, in our project, we create a FHIR profile to define the constraint and extension that's conform to the CSOP data model. And we use FORCE to create and publish our profiles on the simplifier.net. So if you're interested, we publish our profile on simplifier.net/CSOP. If you go to the simplifier.net, you can click on the profiles. You will see the profile that we already create for the project. For example, the CSOP patient profile. You can see the in the snapshot format hybrid or the differentiate from the base URL base resource. And for the mass support, we assign the mass support to the element that we derive from the CSOP data model, such as the Thai citizen ID, the HN member number, and patient ID, patient name as a text. And for issue and concern that, from my experience, the in the project, in Thailand, the hospital provide the pharmacy dispensing within the hospitals and the medication reimbursement in Thailand, we based on the medication data, medication dispense data. But in FHIR standard, there is no direct relationship between claim and medication dispense. So in our project, we use encounter resource and patient resource to link the information from the built-in dataset and to the dispense built-in dataset. And for the healthcare provider license number in Thailand, we start with the Thai alphabet to define the type of provider, such as Wawan for medical doctor and Thothan for dentist. But on the FHIR server, they still not support Thai alphabet for the conditional update in the transition or batch request. For example, if we use a conditional update with Thai alphabet in the transaction bundle and submit post to the FHIR server, we will got the error of invalid conditional URL. But if we remove the Thai alphabet, you will got the successful request of create and update our transaction request. So in our project, we have to separate the Thai alphabet and transform it into the identifier types. For example, MD for the medical license number and the DDS for the dentist number. And the most of the identifier system in Thailand, we have no the official URI. So the same code may be used a different system URI. For example, the hospital code. In our project, we use the UI from the organization that who manage and who publish and maintain the code of the hospital code. And while the another project, they will use the URL that provide the service for searching the querying the hospital code, but it is the same code. So I think we should have the national registry to publish and provide the official UI for the identifier system in Thailand. It should be improve the seamless interoperability in Thailand. And for the last one is identifier type for the Thai national ID that we cannot validate on the FHIR server. If we go to the FHIR web page of the core system for identifier type, if you go to the national person identifier that they define how to specify the national person ID for the for each country. For you know, for example, in Thailand, we use country code as TSA. So if I use the NNTSA as a country national Thai identifier as they mentioned in the specification in the FHIR to validate in the FHIR server, you still got the error of the unable to validate the code. So in our project, we still cannot use identifier type to define the patient in the patient resource. That is all my presentation.
Thank you very much, Dr. Nai. We will proceed to the next presentation. You would like to ask any question first, Dr. Papat, before we go to the blockchain and fires? I think this might be the interspace for this, Dr. Papat. I think Dr. Alvin already asked several questions related to the FHIR server, and Dr. Papat already answered to the chat.
Would
you like
to
answer now or later that discuss more?
I don't know. It's up to you. I mean, I can just repeat the question and put it in the chat.
Okay. Yeah. Then let I think everyone is interested going to the chat. There is an interaction between Dr. Alvin question and respond by Dr. Papat. So let go to Dr. Decho Wood, our partner from Healthtech, to talking about the projects in Silala Hospital. Over to you. Dr. Decha Wood.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Bunchai. Greeting everyone. Before we get started, I would like to give very special thanks to Aileen and Cyril Thailand for having me here. It's a pleasure of mine, okay? Kindly let me introduce myself so we could know each other a bit more. Okay. My name is Decha Pumdai. I have graduated from Khon Kaen Medical School since 2014. I have now run a full-time job as a founder of my own startup company. My team's also known as Healthtech. We operate a network as a service optimized specifically for the healthcare industry by using deep technology like blockchain, self-service identity, decentralized identifiers, and more. We're helping protect patient data when transporting by giving them a patient-based medical record ownership. The health tech system doesn't store data of any kind. We operate as both a network and a protocol to set policies and configure data layer to HR25 standard while verifying the sources and definitions of data in real time. Okay. Right now, we have run our project in many medical schools in Thailand, such as Silat, Sinakrin, Thammasat, Sipat, and other government projects to initiate smart city from smart people and governance. As you were seeing, these are all HR25 projects that we cooperate with Silat Thailand. That is what we have done so far. However, I'm here to sharing my experience about using blockchain combined with HR25 for claim data in Thailand. First of all, I have to tell you that I'm not an informatician, and I'm just general physician who being a tech savvy and autonomous learner of health informatics for years. And I want to apologize in advance for any mistake I might make, okay? So let's get started with technology we use. Blockchain is a decentralized database that has no owner. So this makes our data that's stored on blockchain is trust and transparent. Everyone can check current data and data history on blockchain by themselves. And smart contract is agreement as a code store on blockchain, and this will execute follow state of action by store information of contract. And HR25 interoperability standard intend to facilitate the exchange of healthcare information between anyone else involved in the healthcare ecosystem. I will show you a short video for introduction.
Healthcare information will be converted and stored according to FHIR standards. Drug information, treatment history, vaccination record, and other healthcare information, the hospitals will be the ones storing the information. But we have a way to exchange those information using FHIR standard on top of blockchain technology. This ensures that the information is secure because every time the data is accessed, there has to always be a request and consent over the blockchain. And in the near future, healthcare information exchanges will become decentralized, where everybody will have a personal electronic healthcare card that everybody can use simply by carrying the card. Everybody can view their own healthcare information or let the doctors diagnose it. Receiving care at medical facilities, receiving treatments and displaying healthcare information. Receiving advices for self-care, insurance benefits, and life insurance. Everything could be done within a single card.
Okay. What Blockchain Health is doing today, where they have defined means to go about using the distributed ledger technology. Think of it as an accountant's book or called health ledger that no one can change. And they are using this as a method to allow all of the players across that clinical trial process come together, share that information faster. And they are very much looking at the verifiability of it. For real use case, in healthcare, like identity management. Identity really speaks to the matter of you being able to control your own perspective. So identity is your ability to show yourself as yourself. When you want to, and it's also the ability to control what aspect of you are seeing is the same way of your data. Having to provide the same information over and over and over again in healthcare space is one of the most frustrated things that patients experience, myself included. It would be great if we could just update our information in one place every time we move, and it would just automatically go throughout the system. For example, in our topic of claim data, we can use blockchain infrastructure to create automated claiming process. So that every hospital that patient visit can send significant information real time on trust network, that all data can be verified direct to every patient's payers or insurers who patient have give their consent to. That is real time decentralized exchange mean to be with patient centric and HIV-5 standard and blockchain as a backbone. Okay. So to reach that goal, as we hope that interoperability and public key infrastructure in Thailand public health happen in some day, we start by develop decentralized web application on blockchain and using claim data on CSOP file to build a personal health record. And we have a smart tag which could be easily attached to a wallet protocol and blockchain network. So we have the infrastructure to build an open source of operable standard. So health tag provide public key infrastructure to everyone in healthcare ecosystem to use this as identifier and do transaction on blockchain. Provide registry smart contract and trust identity in ecosystem for hospital and provider. Provide personal record smart contract to patient with following these functionalities such as 1, add and remove data source. This function allow data provider add themselves to patient personal record by checking against registry that defense of personal record smart contract that has low as data provider and patient can remove data source by themselves. 2 is add and remove whitelist. This function will use for patient to allow another people in healthcare ecosystem that has identity on registry to access their data also can remove whitelist access too. 3 is request access. This function will using to store data access and add block number to using for reference on decentralized app at data provider to check permission of access data. So with health hacks at CLAD project, we digitize and standardize electronic health record from fragment hospital information system to file format. We implement the open library to accelerate health tech ecosystem in Thailand, that we hope so. We create a smart CLAD health tech card, which contain a key to access personal health record with ease and high security. And we developed a website to visualize and utilize our digitized standardized personal health record into website, which is accessible through mobile phone. We provide encrypt NFC tag and mobile application for patients as they will generate a unique URL every 5 seconds that contain user ID, temper and nonce. By these information used to validate by server to check that user ID and nonce is correct at the moment once system check and return result of URL is valid. We need to do a multi-factor authentication of user by let user put PIN code that set once tag is generated to check that the tag is belong to live user that can access the data. As this validation can make sure before data will get access and pass secure process to validate, right? For easier to understand, okay. Our system will generate a single HN for all hospital and we generate an ID that can refer to blockchain identity. The ID, the same ID that can identify to real world. If, for example, that is passport and citizen card. Okay. And we provide Docker Compose file with security of data access as public open source. This Docker Compose contains 4 services such as Happy Fire, is an open source of Fire API created on Java language, MySQL for database of Fire system. OAuth2 is permission layer to control write and permission of API access. And Nginx as mask of API layer that will root 2 or R2 for authentication. Okay. Then root 2 happy fire API after authentication server implemented. For every healthcare provider who want to use sync file with basic security, they can go on server by run this Docker compose with some setting of assets. Then they will have file server that can connect to HealthTech service or another healthcare provider that using file standard to share data between file nodes. Then create Python transformation script of government claim file to file format. As all of government hospitals, such as Dr. Bopat said, need to claim from Comptroller General's department by using file standard called CSOP. In this standard, included this result of file by CSOP file type, just like Dr. Bopat and Mr. Natanai have already said that it contained the free file that is Biltran, Bildispense, and OP service. So in this page, we HealthTech provide transformation script of two CSOP file types, Biltran and Bildispense, and provide as a public source code. Okay. And okay, and data source architecture contain Docker compose HealthTech module as number one is index module using for hospital to add themselves to patient personal health record. And number two is access module that using for checking life and permission of provider or viewer to blockchain. And then we deploy smart contract. That is a device to register smart contract. This smart contract will store public key and role of all entity in HealthTech ecosystem by store as dictionary, which key is public key and value as role, which are health provider, hospital, clinic, doctor, nurse, and pharmacist. All those roles will using to check right of interaction with personal health record smart contract function. And then the personal health record smart contract, this smart contract will belong to every patient in ecosystem. Contract will store data sources like a healthcare provider, valid access, that is public key of the people in ecosystem that can request to access patient data online. The access log that will use for checking life of data access by log number of requests that the logic will be used in HealthTech with data adapter that will add it to file server once healthcare provider join HealthTech. Sorry. So the valid access, that is the public key of other people in the ecosystem that can request to access patient data online. This example, for this example, okay. For this example is nurse and pharmacist that has their address is whitelisted and can able to request access data of patient, but doctor as address 3333. Cannot request to access patient data. Yeah, that is also called as electronic consent. Yeah. And the asset log is a log we use for checking right of data access by log number of requests. The logic will be used in HealthTech data access module. Once we want to access data of patient, need to request access on blockchain. Once HealthTech data access module is passed validated, write and permission of viewer, the viewer can see patient data from multi data sources that store on patient personal health record contract. So our end goal, we hope to create a fully decentralized autonomous medical data exchange platform that everyone in ecosystem, also everyone here in AHIN, can participate seamlessly without any barriers. by using blockchain and HL2 and FHIR. For conclusion, there is a good chance that this decade will be remembered as the start of the decentralized age of computing. Blockchain are already being applied to 100 new decentralized apps protocol systems such as Bitcoin that mean to replace existing monetary systems. The healthcare data industry is one of the largest opportunities for this rapidly maturing system. With our solution, a health ledger like this would ensure that patients are the owner of their data, even dental records in the future, medication history, for in this way, x-rays, blood work, DNA, every last part of themselves belong entirely to them. It means that data doesn't stay with only a doctor, who is an important part of the process, but can only give occasional input. It put that data with the individual who has the most incentive and the most potential to use it wisely. And in case with the claim data, it can be automatically done in secure and fast way by just a finger. So our company Go and many other blockchain companies in the world purpose to transforming health toward decentralized and connected care, just like that. That's all for today. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Decho Wood. And we there is one question from Dr. Arvin. Arvin, you can ask this.
Yes, Dr. From the very interesting project. How will you? What is the business model? How will you earn from HealthTag over?
Okay, I think it has to divide in two phases. It must be the government that pay for the infrastructure, right? But in a long run, I think the decentralized ecosystem will maintain themselves if the network is larger. Yeah, every peer gonna blockchain is can be just like give the incentive by themselves, right? Not just trust and identity, but it can provide incentive for everyone who enhance the ecosystem or the network, every peer.
Dr. Bapat, do you like to respond to this question also? Because of this is a one of this is the Sirilat Hospital's project that get it kind of the research and development project to link the information between three hospitals under the Faculty of Medicine Sirilat Hospital. Over to Dr. Bapat.
You mean who gonna pay for the blockchain?
Yes.
At the beginning, we got a budget to pay for this for some time, and maybe we consider that we may move. Right now, we are working on Ethereum, and Ethereum gas fee, as you know, that now is really skyrocket, so it's really expensive. So later, maybe once we have enough traffic, and maybe we can move to another chain, or we can set up some other maybe proof of stake or something. So that's the plan. Right now, I think the most important is that build up the foundation, and we have enough budget from the government for this project to cover the cost for a while. And actually, Dr. Bas, Dr. Dechowat, he also has some plan to implement like a when you retrieve the data from the hospital, you have to kind of pay back, right? Because the hospital have to take care of the infrastructure, right? Have all the server and everything. So maybe you have to pay back to the hospital, but the cost that you don't have to really go to the hospital and by yourself. So if you deduct you consider all the cost of traveling and everything, I think the cost of paying like this is much cheaper. So at the end, I think for sustainable model, maybe the cost maybe even go back to the patient themselves, but they will be happy with the convenience and the other thing that they have, and it's even cheaper than what it is right now.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Wapat. Let me give you the context of this. Dr. Wapat, pharmacist Dattanai, and Dr. Dechowat, what all the three presentations is talking about the projects that we still working with the Sri Lanka Hospital to building the tools to learn the experience, kind of the research and development. And the goal of the Sri Lanka Faculty of Medicine Sri Lanka Hospital is this project is to link at least the medication history of their patient with from their three hospitals. So all the infrastructure is served under the network of the Sri Lanka Hospital. Right now, Sri Lanka Hospital has three hospitals in the network. And one thing that Thailand haven't have the PKI infrastructure yet. So I think the PKI here is that like Dr. Dechowat said, if I'm not wrong, that is the registry, and they create kind of the in-house KPI to use in this system. That's what I understand. It doesn't not go beyond the perimeters or the network of the Sri Lanka enterprise. And that is the context of what we have learned, and we have developed several tools. And then the next speaker, Dr. Rat and Dr. Thanakit, will talking about the new opportunities that the National Health Reform Commission are providing to SIL and to the group and to the GDBI that scale up this health information exchange in a bigger scale, bigger scope. Okay, next, Dr. Rat, could you over to you.
Thank you, Dr. Bunchai. Thank you, Ahin and Digital Health Week for having me today. I'm Rat Panyawat. I'm also from Standard and Interoperability Lab, Thailand. Today, I'm going to talk about FHIR CSOP repository plan. This project is, I would say this plan is more like a draft plan, an idea with the rough idea. We don't have a concrete plan yet what we're going to do in the next months or next 3 months. It's just an idea that we plan to do like this way. So it might not have many detail, and my presentation might be pretty short. So I will start now. I will divide my presentation into two parts. The first part is the first year plan, and the second part is in the second to fifth year plan. For the first year plan, there are many stakeholders in this diagram. There are the hospital side and the government side, the central government side. In the hospital side, I would say there are two main group of hospital. Hospital A and Hospital B. Hospital A is like many hospital in Thailand. They might have an EMR implemented in the hospital, but they don't have the FHIR server in the hospital yet. And the Hospital B is a hospital that somehow they have a FHIR server installed, maybe because they participate in the health information exchange project, like the HealthLink project from GBDI or other project or their own project. But anyway, Hospital A or Hospital B, they all have to create this CSOP data. And this CSOP data have a different way to create a different format. One of them is XML. But after they create this CSOP data, they have to send the data to the existing claim processor. For now, is the three insurance scheme that Dr. Munchai mentioned. And this is the current process, current workflow. The hospital treat the patient and then create the claim data for reimbursement. This is the current workflow. What we plan to do, we didn't change any existing workflow. They do the same thing, but we will implement the new system in the bottom. And like Dr. Prapat and Mr. Natanai said, the two, and also Dr. Deshawat, the tool that the CIRA team create, the open source tool that they create, they will be able to import the CSOP data from any hospital to the tool and convert it to the file format, CSOP data in file format. And after the conversion, they can send it to the central repository of the government. And this is for the hospital that still doesn't have a file server. We will give them a tool to convert data and send to the server as a file. But on the other hand, for a hospital that already have a file server, we will encourage them to extend the support to the CSOP profile, file profile. And after they support the CSOP profile and they have the CSOP data in the file server, they can export it to the CSOP data in file format, same as this one as well. And everyone can send the data to the repository in file. Or we can do the opposite. The server is still here and store the data here, but the one who pull the data is from this side, they can pull the data from here to this one as well. So that is one way to do it. We still haven't finalize the way to do it yet. And maybe we also include other file data into the repository as well. So in the end, in the first year, we plan to have a repository that have CSOP data in file format from all hospitals that participate in this project, this healthcare reform project. And after that, we can use the data for other system. Maybe the executive can use the data in the health management information system to do management things or to policy making. Yeah. So this is the first year plan. We want to do a quick win. It's quick win because our hospital have to do this process anyway, the CSOP data. We just add a little things to utilize the data in another way. Yeah, so this is the first year plan. And after that, in the second year, after the second year to the fifth year, what we plan to do is two things. First, we will add our support to include SNOMED-CT in the network, the health information network. Because right now, this year, the first year, we only just use FHIR as the content standard. But maybe the data in each party might different. If we use SNOMED-CT as a terminology, we can ensure that all the data share the same meaning so that we can utilize it more and more. So the first thing is SNOMED-CT. Maybe we also implement some terminology server or some other way we haven't finalized it yet. The second thing is, in the hospital side, you can see that now there are hospital A and hospital B. We plan to make all hospital A become hospital B, so that all hospital will have the file server in their control. So they will have the file server that they can do anything they want to do with it. and the CSOP data still in this hospital, but we will extend the support to other data, and especially the CIPN data, that is the IPD data. So now the fire server here is more comprehensive, and because it's in the control of the hospital, they can use it to improve the innovation in the hospital. They can implement maybe many other applications to utilize this data. It can be report, it can be the system for the patient, anything that the hospital can decide on their own without the need to rely on the central government to decide for them. And for the central repository, they still have to exchange information between each other. But the data here is more robust, right? Because the source of data is more comprehensive. And other hospital will do the same with hospital A, but maybe we include other system as well to send the data here. So because the data here is better, we can use it in other system beyond the HMIS. Maybe we use this in the registry or use it in with the PHR or other system. And if in the future, the government or other parties, they have other repositories that use the same standard, that is FHIR for content format and SNOMED CT for terminology, then all of them can exchange information in the semantic way. So this is our first year plan and five-year plan. So this is all of my presentation. It's pretty short, right? The next, you want to say anything, Dr. Bunchai?
No, just go on.
So next, I will give the floor to Dr. Tanakrit from, are there any question here? Yeah? Oh, no. Yeah, so the next, I will give the floor to Dr. Tanakrit from GBDI, the creator of the HealthLink project. I think he will talk about the organization in overall and maybe what GBDI will do with this healthcare reform project. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Radford, your introduction. Yeah. And I'd like to say good evening for everyone here. It seems that 9 p.m. is not the problem for us because we always hungry for the knowledge. And today, I would like to thank you, Dr. Bunchai, and also the SEALS Thailand for inviting me to join these valuable sessions. It's very knowledgeable and very beneficial for me as well, as I not the informatic person as our team, but I can learn a lot from SEALS Thailand and also from you guys here. I would like to chat a bit about the project that you might hear quite a lot today. There's a HealthLink. This is a health information exchange platform in Thailand. We have this for about, we established this project for more than 2 years with many cooperation from our partners. So the HIE in Thailand, or we call HealthLink, is come from the problems that the doctors who oversee the patient need so many data that accurate and complete from the patient. But the patient might not know much about the information, like what is a diagnosis they have, what kind of medication they use, and what the allergies that they might allergic to. That quite a big problem for the doctors to make the diagnosis and provide the appropriate treatment for them. in the old days, the patient information is the facility based. It means the patient record in the hospital. And right now we try to incorporate all data of the patient in the symptom platform for the doctors to use to maximize the benefit for the patient, like for the accurate treatment, and also the reduce the patient risk and harmful from the inappropriate treatment, and also the improve the accessibility and satisfaction. Because if the doctor would like to look into the patient data in the private hospital, in the old days, we have to go back to the hospital and request for all information and come back to the second hospital again. And by this project, right now we have 10 participants, 10 hospital, sorry, 100 hospital as our participant for year one. And most of them come from the hospital from Ministry of the Public Health. And the second major group is a university hospital, including Sri Rat Hospital, Ramathibadi Hospital, Chulalongkorn University Hospital, Vachira Payaban, Churaporn, and also the hospital from Khon Kaen, named Sri Nakhrin Maharaj Nakhon Chiang Mai from Chiang Mai, and also the Songkhla Nakhrin as well from Southern Thailand. And we also have the hospital from a military arm, like Phramongkut Kao Phumikhon, and also the police hospital. And the another part is from the private hospital. We got a partner from the major group of the hospital in Thailand named in BDMS or Bangkok Medical Service, and Rajput Hospital, Phayathai Tooth, and Princes, and including the Thonburi group as well. So it's the big team for us to work with, and we try to incorporate all data from the participant hospital into the single platform to oversee all the problems that patients have. This is our participant who work together. We have our partner from FOPH and also the Digital Economy Society Ministry and National Telecom Company, the Krung Thai Bank for EKYC, and we also have the partner from Thai Medical Council to do their doctor authentication. And we also have the other system to plug in, like H4U or in refer from the MOPS and also some partners like PharmaSafe and TrueWeb to help us in this project. But the most important one, when we think of the data exchange, the most important issue that how we make the different SIS to work together. So by this question, we go to Dr. Bun Chai first to consult him that how we make it happen, because the different hospital might be have their different data structure. And then we get the advice from SILT Thailand, not only the Dr. Bun Chai, but Dr. Nawanan helped us, and also Dr. Rat, and so many guys from SILT Thailand helped us in cooperating with the data standard. Like we make agreement on the patient information, the allergy intolerance that we use the TMT and FDA data, the condition we agree to use ICD-10-TM, medication statement, we use a TMT, immunization, we use a TMT procedure, ICD-9-CM and diagnostic report, we use the SNOMED, ROYS, TMLT, and sometimes we use, we allow the text to put in our data and including like the scan paper, because the maturity of the hospital in Thailand is quite health wide range. But the top tier would be the Sirirat hospitals or Jula Lama, Jula Longton or Ramathibodi. But maybe the small hospital might not have the complex system like the medical school hospital like that. So we try to make the agreement on the data standard. It's the most important one. And for the exchange system, I'm sorry, the exchange system, we use the system of Krung Thai Bank to do the KYC and registration for the patient. And we use the Thai Medical Council platform to do the like the authorization for the doctors to access the system. And we use the fire server for every hospital to put in the data in the system, to be the data centers for our platform. This is the complex system. I'm quite not sure why the the system is lost from this picture. And another project that we work with is the COVID fighting system. And we have the quite complex system because in Thailand, we also facing with the problem of the silo system as well. So we try to fight COVID with integrate all the data in the country all together. Like we have the lab data and the lab data, the ward data, the ambulance data, and also the clearance system, like a reimbursement. And we try to incorporate all data all together. So that we make the calling to be the data center for fighting with COVID. So when the patient call to the hotline, so we can put in the patient data in the system and we can see the lab data and then we make arrangement that this case could admit to ward or to the home isolation or community isolation. And also we can call the ambulance from the emergency department to carry the patient from home to healthcare facilities. And also we have the like a management dashboard that what we formulate from the data standardization is the key thing for us as well. And moreover from the movement of Seal Thailand and also the many projects like HealthTech and also the HealthLink and so many projects. So we have the data health workshop in last month, cooperatively work between MOPH and Digital Economy Ministry and Higher Education Ministry and Ministry of Finance and Ministry of Labor work together. And we try to collaborate a work that called National Health Data Platform to link all their patient data all together and also display like the data intelligence and display for the executive, like a executive dashboard. And moreover, we would like to make its benefit for a patient as well, like for their mobile app, for their patient use, and try to accumulate all team, like in the, for the caretaker side, for the finance side, service side and regulator all together. And we hope that it would be beneficial for every healthcare provider in our country. It's like not just only the healthcare provider in the hospital, but we also have the health volunteer privilege, like the health volunteer in the community base as well, and okay, the expert group that can use this kind of data. And so this is the last pictures that we would like to see that the data that we have can work cooperatively and can help us in the management and also the patient care level. And I also discussed in this issue, today we have the APAC this discussion, and we also told about this story to dismiss thing as well than so many quite interested in this kind of work in Thailand. So that's like the demo case that we think that the data standards is very important, and it's the groundwork for us to make every hospital to work together, not just only in the part of the healthcare data, but in the reimbursement or the like the management as well. It would need the data, the accuracy of the data and the readiness of the data is the major platform for us. Thank you very much. And I hope that you might have something to share with
us. Okay. Thank you, Dr. Thanakit. So let me give another context that right now, you may be seem a little bit confused, but the last two speakers talking related to the new initiative that GDBI will work with SILK and with the Ministry of Health. GDBI with Dr. Thanakit is the deputy director of the Governmental Big Data Institute, is the organization under the Ministry of Digital Society, Digital Economy and Society, which is the Ministry of ICT previously. The National Health Reform Commission is not under both a ministry, it's under the cabinet. So the commission think that if Ministry of the DES, the Ministry of Digital Economy and Society, and Ministry of Health can work together on this project, and also working with the Ministry of Science and Technology, which is in Thailand we call the Ministry of Higher Education, Science and Innovation. So that is the new ministry that combine higher education and science and technology. The previous science and technology into one ministry. So this is the context. So the two speaker, Dr. Lat and Dr. Thanakit, talking related to the new initiative, which will use the FHIR standard and create the repository for the at first for the claim data to use for the management information system. But what Dr. Thanakit talking is the current projects that the GDBI also do for the countries and for the hospital outside the Ministry of Health, but also linked with Ministry of Health, that called the Health Link. It is the health information platform to connect to enable provider in different hospital to look at the patient data from the another hospital when the patient consent to do it, and the doctor are eligible or authorized that they are really the doctor to see that. So the health link is more on the provider and provider health information exchange to be more knowledgeable on the patient when they are facing the patient that never come to that hospital and they need the history like laboratory data or like medication data and laboratory data. That is the context. But you can see that right now we are working with several stakeholders to do the project that Dr. Rudd said that in the first year, what we will do, the second to 5 year, what we will do. Right now, I think we should open the floor for the question. Actually, if you access to the chat window, you can see that a lot of questions come from Dr. Alvin and Joey from the National Health Insurance in Philippines or PhilHealth, and Dr. Papat, Dr. Natanay, and Dr. Lat also has respond to that. So I think I would like to open the floor for the discussion and question and answer. Anyone would like to? I think Cha, we can unmute everyone, and then if anyone have comment or discussion, please raise your hand, and then we can help you ask the question.
So my question is, if you will get the CSOP files from every hospital using the FHIR standard, it means you have to go to each hospital and get their consent, right?
No. Why do we need consent for hospital?
Because the CSMBS, they get the CSOP file as a matter of claims processing.
Mm-hmm.
But why would they give you the CSOP file also? Is there a reason?
I mean, the CSOP file generated by the hospital, and they just send the CSOP by email, via email to the CSMBS. Yeah.
Okay.
So the file is there in the hospital. So we just take it to use in our parser, that's all. So we don't need to do anything with CSMBS.
The challenge is that who will gonna ask a hospital to kind of do additional job to send this to the file server to par it, something like that. Maybe the project, this initiative, the first year project, maybe have to provide the file server for each hospital, and just ask the hospital send it to that cloud server. It might not be physically inside the hospital, but they can send it to the big cloud, like the governmental cloud services. That is the matter of negotiation, the investment that the government will do. Okay, Dr. Alvin.
Can't you just tell them to also email it to SILPH? Well,
No, I mean, it's against our plan that we would like. I mean, you see, if we hold all the data, again, if they want to use the data, they have to ask the permission from us. I mean, we foresee that, I mean, right now, I mean, we know that many hospitals, they have really good idea. They have some initiative, but to get the data out from the hospital is not easy. I mean, we have seen many hospitals try to work with startup to build up the economy, I mean, the ecosystem. So we hope that once we empower them to be able to use their own data, so they can feel like freely they have power to work with any health tech startup, and then this can scale up. I mean, we don't have to ask for permission or waiting in a long queue for some centralized institute to do all this. This is our plan, to decentralize and empower the hospitals.
And a little bit context to this for the civil servant CSMBS scheme, the payer is the Ministry of Finance. and they have two processor of the claim data. One is the center for healthcare data, we call the CHI, which is under which is the mother sister to the TSIS. We working together for years, for 10 years. And another processor is National Health Security Office, NSSO. What I mean is that they split the hospital into two groups. The small hospital, like 800 small hospital, will send the data to the NSSO, and then the NSSO process the CSMBS claim and send the result to the Ministry of Finance. That first part. For the another group, the big hospital, which is cover around 90% of the outpatient claim. 90% of the money of the outpatient claim, around 70% of the visit. 160, 70 hospital or big hospital, both in Ministry of Health or outside Ministry of Health, like the University Hospital. These will send to the CHI, the Center of Health Information, Healthcare Information, to process the claim. And when they're processing that, they will send the result to the Ministry of Finance to the reimburse. Because of we have separate processor, these projects. Dr. Lat, could you show your slide, the first year slide, so you can have more idea about this.
Two processors, but same rules.
Yes, yes, because of that is under CSMBS. So you can see that existing claim processor, they have two claim processor. We will not interfere with this business model because of they will have to change a lot. So that's why we said, let provide the repository of or starting with claim data of the CSMBS. And then use this repository for the management information system to give them this. So the GDBI agree that they will do to be the repository. So what GDBI will do that they will organize the data into warehouse, into mart, and then provide this service to the hospital, to the Ministry of Finance, to the related governmental, that they allow to work with the ministry, to work with this repository data. So this is the idea of starting to have compile to the FHIR standard. Like Dr. Papat said, if the hospitals, we don't want to interfere the HIS, but we also training the developer, the hospital, the EMR developer to learn about the FHIR. And if they ready, then they will be able to do their EMR to comply with FHIR, and then they will have the can have the FHIR facade like you mentioned. Is it the part of the EMR vendor? Is it more confused or more understandable, Dr. Papad?
More understood.
Okay. Alia asked the question that what trigger the demand of FHIR? In our country, we demonstrate it used during COVID-19 submission of lab tests to the ministry every very well, but it did not fully take off to do other exchange like what you have shown. Any tip for this? Because fire is what we need as we connect our hospital in the healthcare provider network. Dr. Papat, would you like to answer?
I have already post there. I think all of SEAL team, we especially Dr. Bunchai, I mean, he has many links and has been involved, and also Dr. Rat and many people in our team. I mean, we are kind of have network and have a chance to learn about what the goal of that institute, what are there any projects involved in health data. And then, I mean, most of the health projects, they involve data anyway, right? So every time we just try to introduce fire there when we talk, sometimes we just have a chance to just mention fire to trigger their interest that what is fire? And then we just keep doing this, I think. I mean, Dr. Bunchai has done all this a lot. Until, I mean, there is a chance, we plan, for example, when we come up with a plan that, okay, after our pilot project, we would like to use CSOP, but we don't have any budget, we don't have anything. So we wait for the right moment, we're looking for opportunity. And then there come a budget, I mean, come at Silat Hospital. And at the beginning, I mean, nothing to do with CSOP project at all. So we have to think that, okay, how to align some part of CSOP project to the full objective of the budget. And then we use the fire like a thing inside, like a core, and then we wrap up to get the output that the grantor, the budget come with the objective on the budget. So that's how we move it up.
The secret is, Aliyah, the secret is that we know what is good for the countries, and we try to find the opportunity and ally or the funder or the opportunity into the fire standard. So what really triggered that is that the perseverance of us, that we gather people who passionate like Dr. Papat, Dr. Rat, Dr. Nadanai, and several people that when we talk, when we study together, we see, we understand more and more, and we see more opportunity that, oh, this is, should work. At first, it's kind of the learning peak, the learning. We don't know much about the fire, and we learn from Saila, we learn from doing the pilot project. So you can see that SEAL is kind of the very, very informal group, and people in SEAL have technical, clinical experts, and also have a connection with the policy and also the several things. So we use that as the kind of the, let's say, we call sandbox, sandbox that can produce the tools, and being seeing the opportunity to demonstrate that this should work. That one thing. The other thing is that we have to kind of the persuade several group that doing standard is the way that we can do the health information exchange integrated data. And one use case that people are now begin to realize that having standard is really important is the development of the TMT. TMT have been used for 8 years, and just these 2-3 years that many systems are using TMT as the identification of the drug, like a project of the drug price for the Ministry of Internal for the Ministry of Commerce, and the electronic procurement system of the from the Ministry of Finance, and the the reimbursement of the CSMBS. And right now, the National Health Security Office also using the TMT as the identifier of the drug for the reimbursement of the emergency case that they pay by item, they don't pay by the capitation. And I just got the good news just a few days ago that right now Ministry of Public Health agree to announce that TMT will be used across the country in the Ministry of Health, Ministry of Public Health hospitals. And so having use case and also the perseverance to show the benefit of the standard, I think it need people who are
dedicated.
Not just dedicated, but also agree that this is the way, and we work collaboratively. That and it not have to be formal. I think the key. I learned a lot from Ahin that we can be we can do our job, and at the same time we do the public thing that we see we think that is the good, the public, for public good together. So I think that model of working in AHIN, like the network, also has been worked quite well in Thailand. So I did not approach people as formally. I don't have any power. Only that I have is that we are friends. So is it a good thing? If this is a good thing, why don't we work together and be ready to work harder to kind of the giving first, and then seeing that we would like to see happen would be happen. I think I answer so so long. So any more questions or comments, Joey? I saw your three questions. Would you like to share your question, and Dr. Papad, Dr. Lat maybe help to answer those?
I think she left already, Dr. Bunchai.
Okay, I saw. Oh,
okay. Yeah, she said goodbye already.
Okay, sorry. So I think there is a lot of friends in Thailand from the national standard in STDA, several people from the in STDA also has any comment or question. Anis, any comments? And I saw one of the Fiki, president of Fiki, talking about in the Digital Health Weeks, and then you also have the activity in Indonesia. Right, over. Yeah. Oh, maybe Anis is not in front of the camera. Yeah. Dr. Bodin, any comments?
Maybe I have just a few words. Thank you very much for all you've done an excellent job. And I have little skill now on this area. One of the questions that I'd like to ask, could you make it more simpler, make it simplify, I don't know, the thing that you've been building seem to be complicated from my view. Can you, I don't know, maybe when you need to scale up across the country, maybe to other countries, this is one of the issues that we need to handle. Besides, not mentioning about the cyber security issue, that put that apart.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you for that comment. You know, because of I know that this community, ANS community, people are more savvy on that. So the content that we talking here is more on deeper than that talking with the policy maker. I have learned over the year that talking with the policy maker, we maybe have to make it very simple and have to agree on some information may lost. We will improve this in both the communication term and also the complex of the architecture that we are designing.
Right, maybe Dr. Desho would talking about the blockchain, the architecture. I just curious that could you make it simpler than what you've done?
Yeah, I try to do my slide simple way as I can. Yeah, explain what we do.
So this is the question for Dr. Thanakit. I think Dr. Ekapop from the National Center of National Cancer Institute asked that nowadays how many patients in HealthLink project?
Thank you for your question, Nakap. I think that right now the Cancer Center is our partner as well, because we work with the department of the medical department of MOPH and their hospital in under the umbrella of their medical department is our partner as well. And for the registration of the patient who participate in the HealthLink, right now is near 100,000. After we open this project by mid of September. Yeah, and the doctors who use the system is around 4,000 doctors here right now. And I think it's just climbing up because we already announced to the public and in so many channels, like in the electronic system and also the booth or event. And one more thing that I would like to add more about the prayer questions about the success of the fire implementation. I think that in the healthcare data perspective, I think that the most important is the data standardized, because we have so many participants who come from the so many backgrounds and from various SIS. So it's might not easy to talk to each other. So we're looking for the standard to make us to come closer. So that's why we asked Sild and Dr. Bun Chai team to help us on this. And by our experience and study, we found that the fire is would be the best solution for us to work together among our team and use that for the participating hospital. And next year we're gonna ramp up to 200 or more hospital to join in a healing project as well. By the advocacy of Sild Thailand is very beneficial for us, because they quite work hard for us to come with the solution what is the data standard we're gonna use to be the the standard for the country. So I think that it would be the key thing, because the participant or the users looking for what should be the common language for us to work together. I think that is an important one for us. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Thanakit. I saw Dr. Thepputhorn from Lao. Do you want to give some word to our community? So anything? I think Lao are going to have the activity in the Digital Health Weeks on December 3rd, right?
Yeah, good evening, everyone. Thank you, Dr. Bunchai. From the fire implementation in Thailand is the good example for Lao to develop the enterprise architecture and standard in Laopedia. I think your experience is really useful. We will learn from you and the ASEAN country. Yes, I hope the all of you to join the digital health week for Lao and that you mentioned the test on Friday. Thank you, Dr. Okay. Bunchai.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Thepputhorn. I have a question from Dude Ventura that what base standard do you use for all the member hospital? I don't quite understand what it means by base standard. Could you explain us more about what do you mean by base standard?
I think you maybe it's about the standard value set. It's like a CD10, ICD9, and I think that's all right. That we use in hospital. That really becomes standard throughout the country. ICD10, ICD9.
Go
down. Just no. So we don't have. we don't really have standard for this. It's still different between hospitals.
So I think what you mean by standard is a technical standard, right? The technical standard. We don't have the main. The specification. And most of the messaging sending might be in format of Excel, or it may be text file, or maybe on the CVS or something like that. So it depends on the organization to specify the specification of the messaging or the technical like that. We don't have the specification for the semantic. We have quite a few, like the identification of the patient, use the national ID number for the diagnosis. We use the ICD-10, and for the procedure, ICD-10-TM and the ICD-9-CM. For the identification of drug, we use the TMT. For the lab, we use the TMLT. And we still have several standard that we haven't implemented in Thailand, like as I mentioned, the Snowmass CT, which is the semantic standard for the data. That I think I answered the question. So I before we close, actually in this webinar, we have Dr. Kawin and Dr. Thanapop is all our member. I would like both of you to say some word to the communities. Dr. Gawin, any comments? Dr. Gawin is worked very hard to install all the learning about the the fire server implementation. Over, Dr. Gawin.
Thank you very much, Dr. Bunchai. I think we are still in the very early phase of the fire implementation here in Thailand. So we might have many things to learn more.
But I'm very glad to hear about our project that we were sharing today. And thank you everyone for joining us today.
Okay, Dr. Thanaphop. Dr. Thanaphop is also one that learning mapping the one of the data set standard data set that used in many projects in Ministry of Health to the fires. Dr. Thanaphop, any few words?
Thank you, Dr. Bhutchai. Sorry, I can't turn on my camera now. I think HR7 fire is kind of like robust standards for health information exchange and yeah, so I really appreciate that you guys appreciate our work and also what we have done in Thailand. I think we can have more collaboration or in our community. Thank you very much.
Okay. Dr. Thanaphop is at the University of Khon Kaen University, and he is one that using fire to immunization certification projects in Khon Kaen University. And it seemed like the Khon Kaen University would like to develop the immunization information system, starting with the COVID vaccination certification. Yeah. So we learn in Seoul. We learned several projects. This is one of the project that we just elaborate to the communities. Okay. Dr. Alvin, are you still there? Or he have left? So if there is no any question, I think we already passed 9:30, and thank you very much to all of the participants, and let be involved and for the participant that haven't be the AHIN member, please maybe the go to the website go to the web page of AHIN and then be the member. The member cost no cost, and we will have distribute the activity that AHIN will do. And if we have several opportunity to get the fund from the developing partner like the McGovern Foundation or the World Bank or the Asia Development Bank or WHO to building capacity in Asian countries. And if that opportunity that come, then we will announce those, and then everyone AHIN member can be applied for that. That is one thing that we working with the developing partner to build up the capacity in our regions. So, and then it's time to close the meeting. And again, thank you very much, and expect to see you again in the near future. So thank you. Thank you, Kap.